What's going on, everybody? Your boy Dusty Bones, your boy Mason Frost. We are here to give you one of these famous reaction videos everybody likes to do on the YouTubes these days. And did you ever think we'd get a new Beatles song? You said you were a Beatles fan, Frost. I am not, but you are, and I think that's going to make.
Yeah, I mean, I guess you don't really ever expect new music necessarily from a band that doesn't exist anymore. I mean,
fair enough.
A lot of times they go back in the vaults and release stuff. But I mean, I think at this point, the Beatles have pretty much put all of that out there. I don't, you know, I think they're saying that there's not really anything left for them to even to work on, you know, that's in the vaults or anything. So
up until, I don't think there is anymore because I think this was the last of it. Let's talk about the track for a minute. The track is called Now and Then. It just came out last week. And it is a demo. It started out as a demo that John Lennon recorded on piano and recorded onto a cassette tape. And I think
like late 70s, right? Like 78, maybe something.
Yeah,
like that.
I think so. Cause they got it from Yoko Ono. I can't remember everybody's name. There's John, Ringo,
George and Paul.
George and Paul. Okay. So Paul got the demo from what's that crazy woman's name? Yoko. From Yoko Ono. And they started working on it in the 90s, and that's where they recorded all of George's guitar parts that they use in the final cut. Well, then George died in 2001, I believe. Was it 2001 that George died?
I don't know. I don't know exactly when he died.
And so finally, AI technology has gotten good enough that they could separate John's vocals from the piano to be able to properly mix it.
Yeah, I think that's why they never finished it in the 90s, was so they couldn't isolate his vocals.
Yeah. And so people are saying, like, I've been seeing now, like I said, I'm not a Beatles fan, but I'll defend them on this. People are saying that, oh, they just used AI. Because they did use AI, people are thinking, oh, they just used AI to recreate John Lennon, and this is bullshit. It's just some AI shit that they did to make money. And that's not the case at all. They used AI to polish up something that John had already recorded.
And although not to, if you wanted to go the conspiracy theorist route, and I didn't even think about this being a possibility until while you were just talking about it and started talking about it, is that, you know, they have obviously the recording and whatever quality it already was, so they knew how the melody and the lines should sound. And we've heard how a good AI is. Is it possible they had AI just re-record the lyrics to sing it following the melody of the original recording?
I don't know. I'll tell you what. We might be able to find something out when we watch the video, because I don't know how much lyrics there is, how much things just kind of... I feel like there's probably going to be a lot of repeating in there.
I've only heard it twice now because I haven't wanted to like just wear it out. And both times I've listened to it, I've had like chill bumps listening to it. So,
well, let's take a listen right now and let's check out Now and Then from the Beatles. And they've got a whole ass music video and everything that's going with this. So what you're saying is maybe they recorded some more shit with AI to add to what existed already, like they had it.
Well, maybe not even that. Maybe they just had AI do a re. You know, like if you made like the AI Axl Rose that we see pop up in the Discord sometimes, where they make him sing, but you could make AI Axl Rose sing the actual lyrics of Axl Rose. So what if they did that with John Lennon, made a John Lennon AI? And just had it re-sing the lyrics of this song so they could have a clear vocal.
I don't know. They made a documentary about it. And
I don't know what they're claiming they did exactly. So I'm just saying, if you want to go
they separated the piano from the vocal.
Okay.
And they did
know,
it.
I don't quite know how AI would do that, though. That's why the only thing I don't get is, like, how would AI be able to go into a recording and be able to unmix something like that? I don't know,
because it learns what it's listening for. So like it's listening for the voice So it's going to take out the piano because you're isolating that. So you only want the voice. You don't want the piano in there. And then you turn around.
Well, I guess what I mean, though, is from my understanding, like a music file, like if it's a digit, like I say it was an MP3 file, even if when you're, you know, had that in whatever mixer, you have several different channels of audios. When you mix that down into an MP3, it's going to compress that into one audio wavelength.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I'm not sure how it's splitting up. If it merges them into like one audio file, like one channel, how do you separate things? Because it's reading as one thing at that point, isn't it?
Well, we can do this today. I can take a song and upload it to one of the they have websites now where you can make your own karaoke tracks, and it does the same thing.
Well, I've heard some stuff like that, and I know some people do like YouTube. They'll do like instrumental versions of a track, and that's basically what they're doing. But then you can always usually still hear the voice, and they're like a faint. They never get it completely right, from what I hear.
Well, maybe if it was like a professional, if you had a professional in there that is fine tuning the program specifically for the audio that you're presenting right now versus something that you can put anything into and mix, you would be able to fine tune it a little more. And plus, well, I had Beatles money, I'm pretty sure I could do it.
Oh, yeah. Well, Paul's a billionaire, so.
Yeah, so I think you know, you throw enough money at any problem, and the problem was
that was really a genuine question, because I mean, I don't know enough about obviously mixing stuff like that. So for me, just thinking about that, when you say there's this one audio file that they're splitting like that, I don't really understand, because I don't, you know.
Well, that's what they're doing. So I watched the documentary on it, and according to the documentary, what happened was they put the audio in, and it, and like the audio had the voice and the, so let's think of it as an image. Okay. Yeah. So you've got the voice over here, and then you've got the piano that's on top of it, but it's just one image. And all we've ever known was this to be one image. All right. So now we take out one aspect of it, and we've got holes, right? From where, and gaps and stuff from where we've removed something. So the AI fills in those gaps.
So what the way audio file works, when it compresses it into that single channel, it's not really merging it all together. It's just layering them. It's still layered within that channel.
No, it is still all together. Or at least this one was, according to the documentary. It was all still together, because like, see how he's putting a cassette tape in right now?
Yeah,
this is what
I've never even heard the demo. I'm sure you can find it, but I've never even since this song come out, haven't looked up the demo to hear what it sounds like, because I don't even know what it originally sounded like.
Well, when we're done here, I recommend going and seeing the documentary, because it's pretty fascinating how they were able to do it, some of the things that they can do with technology. But no, they didn't just create a fake John Lennon like everybody thinks that they did. That's not what happened at all. At least they had the foresight in the 90s to film some of this shit when they
They probably then at that time thought that was going to be the last time they probably put out something together.
Yeah. Now I'm pretty sure that's not John Lennon. Call me crazy. That's one of the conspiracies you never hear, is that John Lennon's alive. But it is a little, I don't know, it's pretty cool how they go in this video from young to older and everything. Because AI can be used to make the video quality better. Of course, they had Beatles money in the 90s, so they weren't recording shitty quality video back then either.
I don't know how much money he had in the 90s, but Paul didn't get the rights to the Beatles songs back until, I think, after Michael Jackson died, because Michael Jackson owned the rights to the Beatles.
Yeah, that was bullshit what Michael Jackson pulled on him. And that's coming from a guy that's not even a fan. That's coming from a guy that's, I feel like Paul got screwed by Michael Jackson in that whole deal.
Well, I think Michael Jackson knew that Paul McCartney was trying to get the rights back and outbid him for it.
Yeah, which was a piece of shit thing to do. Like, yeah, to so a that, friend, you know what I mean?
It wasn't like, yeah, that's what I'm saying, though. It wasn't like Michael Jackson just ended, bought the rights. They were friends and knew that Paul was trying to get them and still went behind him.
Yeah, that's a piece of shit move. Man, I'm going to tell you, even though he is not nearly as gray as Paul is, Ringo looks like shit. I don't know
what Ringo looks like. I mean, Ringo's always looked a little weird, so.
I always figured Ringo would. Well, they're all assholes in real life. That's one thing that even John Lennon, when he was
To be fair, John Lennon's my least favorite Beatles. So,
like, he was all, I always heard he was a prick when he was alive. And Paul, he's an asshole to fans, and so is Ringo. So, it's like at this point, man, like, I get that you're billionaires and shit, but don't treat your fans like shit. Like, don't forget where you
I
came.
I don't know what they do. I guess I don't know.
That basically, if you meet them somewhere and you're like, oh my God, I can't believe you're here. Will you sign something for me? No.
Oh, I do remember something a while back of, I think Mike, maybe it was Paul, said he quit signing stuff because people were selling it on eBay or something like that.
Yeah. I just this never.
Course, well, maybe course right one. You what?
You want to hear the chorus?
Well, I was gonna say this chorus right here for me. The wild thought I had when I was listening to it the other day was that chorus right there is a young John Lennon singing with an old Paul McCartney.
Poor John never got old, so.
Well, I know, but I'm just saying the juxtaposition of obviously when they were both young, growing and playing together. And then they got this old recording of John when he was still young, and now Paul at the end of his life is singing with John again, but like his younger self. I don't know. It's kind of just a weird thought.
It is. And for them, this has to be something amazing. You know what I mean? To be able to do this with their friend that died years ago. And there's something else we're just recently able to do cleanly is to take a video, check out the background and completely replace it without there being a green screen or something to key out of it. You know what I'm saying? Like, and we've even done this on Guns and Radio, just not in such a grand example of it. Cause I've got a green screen. It's fucking packed away in the attic and it hasn't seen the light of day in years. And last year on our show, when we did the thing where I'm running from the dinosaur and all that shit, I was just here in my living room and then I did all of that on my phone. So, I mean, if I had, you know, their kind of budget, you know what I'm saying? It's easier now to do a lot of the effects.
The only thing that is you can always still tell it's out of place. Like, I don't know what it, I don't know if it's a depth thing. I don't know if it's you lose the depth of it.
Lighting is one of them because, like, who is this? We got George.
Yeah.
And I guess this is also George.
Yeah, they're both George.
Okay. Well, like, young George here is lit differently. You know what I mean? The light's hitting him in different places than it is over here. And plus, I mean, it's got a different kind of color to it because this is probably originally in black and white, and it's probably been colorized.
That's another thing I never understand how they do. Do they just make up colors when they colorize black and white images, or how do they?
I don't know. I really don't know. Now they have AI. Now AI just does it.
Yeah, but how does it know? Because black and white, it could be anything, unless there's like information within the coding that, you know, that you just can't visually see.
Now, there is on some black and white items have, what do they call it? Microscopic data that you can go in, basically like a forensic, and it left article, like particle. I don't know how to word it, but they can take some. I have seen some old black and white shows, like, for example, there's a few episodes of Doctor Who that were lost and then found, but when they were found, it was only found in black and white. And same with a few other shows that were found only in black and white. And then somebody discovered that if they put it in some kind of computer that they had, they zoomed way the fuck in at a microscopic level, that there was color particles in there. So then they programmed a computer to take those particles, shade them out, and basically recover all of the color from those black and white versions of film.
That's wild.
So I don't know if all of them, because those were originally filmed. The ones I'm thinking of were originally filmed in color. Then the color version was lost. It was converted to black and white for some broadcasters. So I don't know how that works, but I know my grandmother and when my grandfather died, I upscaled many of their older photos of them when they were dating or first married and stuff like that, because she asked me to. So I went in and upscaled a lot of those, and I used AI to colorize all of those pictures. And there's one of my dad that I colorized for my dad. I pulled it way up and colorized it, and it was my dad and my Uncle Mike together, and they were kids sitting by a Christmas tree, and it knew that the tree was supposed to be green, and it knew that the presents were supposed to be like different colors. There were some purples in there and some pinks and shit like that. And so I don't know. I don't know how it works, but it could have been AI that colorized some of these all.
I'd have to try testing it. So I'd have to like take a picture that I know what the colors are, turn that picture into black and white, but then take a picture of it, so I know that there's like no metadata from where I converted it that it could be reading, and then upload that picture of the black and white. How I would have, that's the only way I'd be trust that thing and be like, if you can get this.
Oh, that would be cool. Especially like your room with the dinosaur and the different colors on the Guns N' Roses poster behind you and shit like that. That would be neat.
Oh yeah.
But yeah, dude, this AI shit's getting scary. Okay, see, like, the guys from the Sergeant Pepper costumes over here next to the guys dressed all normal and shit, they just look out of place.
I know. I was sitting here just thinking, why did they choose the video that they chose of him dressed in that era? Like, why not choose a different era where they were dressed more normally?
I don't know. It's like when you've got a friend that shows up, you know, it's like, You maybe you're having a business dinner or something, so you invite one of your friends to come along, and then he shows up dressed like a pirate while everybody else is in suits and ties. Oh, they didn't even tell the orchestra that it was a Beatles song they were working on. They had no clue. Is that video of John pointing the only one they could have got?
That's a weird video that they put in there, too. Yeah, I don't know why they chose the things that they chose to put in here. A lot of them seem out of place.
They probably have several hours worth of footage from the years it took them to, because they worked on this for, like, what, 2 years in the 90s? And then they was like, well, fuck it. We can't get John to sound worth a shit on this crappy recording. There's nothing we can do about it. Before AI came along, and
well, I just mean like, I mean whatever videos they used for the cutouts of when they are putting George and John in the video, like, I don't know. I feel like they feel very odd choices.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know. Maybe they're from different.
Especially for this type of song. This is not an upbeat, funny song. So why you got John over there going?
Well, I think a lot of it too is a celebration of the band. You know what I mean? Like, they're aware that they will never, like, this is the last bite of the apple. And I think that they're very well aware of that. And I feel like a lot of this is done in tribute to everything they did previously. Now, I could be guessing, because, like I said,
I guess thematically the content of the song, though,
it doesn't match
It doesn't match the song itself and the content of the song.
Yeah.
For it to be like a slow, very poignant, like, you know, kind of like a melancholy song.
Yeah, I wish it would have been a brighter and happier upbeat song for their last one, but I don't know. Maybe that's more of a farewell feeling for the band. I don't know. Like I said, I'm not a fan, so I don't understand a lot. Like, this scene I get, he's supposed to look like he's leading the orchestra.
Yeah.
But that's not what looks like is going on here. Or maybe it's supposed to be that he's there with them in spirit.
it just doesn't match the song.
Oh, man. So it's like when you get your grandpa a male stripper as a joke for his birthday. He's like, oh, God, and he just looks straight ahead.
Does one of Paul's eyes sit like a half inch lower than the other one? Did you see that?
I think so. I think he's got like a lazy eye.
Like, that eye on the right, does it not look like it's just like lower on his face than the left eye?
Maybe. Who knows? He's British. Oh, hang on. I think he's just got a lazy eye.
Yeah, it doesn't look as bad when he's young, but now that he's old, it shows him as an old man again.
Oh, that's fine. I've got one of those too. They always were some ugly motherfuckers. I don't say that. But then again, what rock star is just gorgeous? Except the female ones.
What do you mean? In the 80s, all of them were.
Well, yeah, because they were wearing makeup.
So are the ladies.
Fair enough. Have you ever seen Lady Gaga without makeup?
I don't know. Probably not. Probably
would Google that when we're done. And there it was, Now and Then by the Beatles. So what do you think, man? Like, what do you think about this video?
I really like it. Well, the video was kind of cool. But like I said, some of the cut parts of the videos that they used for the people seemed out of place.
Yeah.
Closer to the end, they started making more sense. So like the end ones, like all that from basically that end that we just, from where we unpaused it, it started making a lot more sense. Like you pointed out, the one where it's supposed to look like him conducting the orchestra, even though he's doing it like a goofy way. And then like right there, that outro.
It's like an alien came down from outer space, had heard about what a human does when he conducts an orchestra, and is then immediately tasked with conducting an orchestra.
He just read the directions of what an orchestra. Yeah, but the ones at the end made sense too. Like it was the end was kind of like what you were talking about, like made more sense in what you're talking about as like a celebration and like memory or whatever. That outro felt more like that because it was like a montage of different videos and pictures from different eras and stuff like that.
I can't speak as a Beatles fan because, as I've stated several times in this video, I am absolutely not. As a song, I don't think it's great. Just to be a little critical there, I think it's kind of a, you know, it's just, would I listen to this if like some other fucking band came up with it? No. If you took any other band and put this exact same song out, I don't think we'd be talking about it right now. But the surrealness comes from the fact that the Beatles did it. John's dead. The fucking other one's dead. I forget which one, George. And, you know, I think for Ringo and Paul, this is a cool thing to get to do the thing one more time that they used to do with the people that they used to do it with. Even though they're not here physically, the finished product contains parts that were created by them. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And plus, the Michael Jackson thing probably could have had something to do with it. They probably could have stuck this motherfucker on the shelf and was like, well, if this fucker's going to make money off of it after he just fucked me over, then I guess fuck him. We just won't do it. Which no,
as the song, I think it's a great song, and not because it does anything necessarily new or different, or, you know, because it didn't, it basically stayed, it didn't even have a change up throughout the song. It was basically verse, chorus, verse, chorus, and then like I think like a last verse, and then it just ended. Like there was nothing, like even the guitar section that's technically the solo wasn't nothing. It was just a few notes or whatever, back and forth. And but I don't think that's the reason why it's great, because like there's like a lot of Beatles songs in their catalog that are like, it's the sound, and I think it's like the energy it provides. Like there's an ambiance in the music. Like I listen to like a lot of music, like I'm a big The Cure fan, and they have like a lot of songs that like just kind of never go anywhere like that. They're just kind of jammy like that. And as long as it's a good jam, like you can get lost in just the melody and the jam, and like, there's like some really long songs like that I listen to that, you know, could be like 6 minute long songs and it's over before you know it. Cause if you're, especially if you're driving at night, like this would be like a really good night driving song, I think.
Right, but it made the fuck sleep.
No, but that's why, like, it's kind of, I don't know.
Let me ask you this, as a Beatles fan, does this sound like what you would, cause see, when I think of the Beatles, I think of like, She Loves You. Yeah. 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 Ticket to Ride. I don't fucking know. Come Together. Like there's a certain sound I'm thinking of. So as a Beatles fan that probably has an appreciation for the entire discography, does this seem like it fits in with the rest of the discography?
Yeah. I mean, that's one of the things I love about the song is that it actually sounds like a Beatles song. It's not just a song that Ringo and Paul did called it the Beatles. Like to me, it actually sounds like a Beatles song. And because like especially in their later years they did a lot more kind of like weird kind of sounds in there, and like even though this one doesn't have that much, you know, it had some string sections and like that orchestra we saw, and so there were some kind of musical arrangements in there as well, and they did a lot of like stuff with that, especially during their later years, like the last 5 or so years.
Okay.
Like a lot of the upbeat poppy Beatles songs you hear were from the first few years.
See, that's what I'm thinking. Like, usually if it's got something to do with the Beatles, if it didn't come out while they were still in black and white, then I probably haven't heard it.
Now, I think some of the ones you named were, like, later years, but, like, I think Come Together was a little bit later, you know. I can't remember what album that was on, but...
I think it was I Am the Walrus that made me write off the Beatles, just be like, okay, this is shit.
Goo 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 Jube.
Yeah, I fucking hate that song.
I am he and we are she and...
I am me and you is me and we should all just smoke some weed and
One, I love that song, but do you know why I love that song?
Why is that?
And this will maybe make the song make more sense to you. So back when the Beatles in that day, and around that time period, there were all these like people, writers and stuff, and people were trying to like figure out what certain songs mean, because Beatles have a lot of weird songs and with different interpreted meanings and stuff like that. Like they had some wacky lyrics out there, and people were trying to figure out like, oh, what the secret meaning of this song was and that song, and everybody had their own interpretation. And so they wrote this song, and the lyrics are all over the place, crazy, because people were coming up with crazy theories about what their songs meant. And so they wrote this song that's complete gibberish, and they knew it was gibberish, but they wrote it out there as a, like a real song
to fuck with
people. And it has no meaning, obviously. Like there is no meaning. The meaning of it is that, you know, they're making fun of all the people that were doing crazy interpretations of their songs and saying it had this deeper meaning beyond what the lyrics just said. Because you know how people will see a lyric and they'll be like, oh, read in between the lines what they're really saying is this, this, and this. It goes deeper than, and this is basically them saying like, no, we just said what we said.
Yeah. Oh, that's funny, man. I see. Okay, so I can respect that, I guess, then. Yeah. But, guys, what did you think? Why don't you let us know in the comment section below. If you like this video, be sure to give us a thumbs up. Click the subscribe button, ring that bell icon so you can be notified anytime we post new music, rock and roll-themed content. And, Frost, thanks for coming on with me, man, on such short notice and watching this video here. I appreciate it, especially with you being a Beatles fan and me not being. Then, you know, we had a good little two sides of the coin here that we was presenting here. So thank you guys for watching. Have a good night.